BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Renninger Berks Guild of Craftsmen.
Hi, and good evening, and welcome to tonight's edition of Your Berks Craftsmen. I am Kay Bennecoff, your host, and we are here live with six of our guests tonight, our craftsmen. They are so happy to be here tonight, and they are celebrating, of course, March 17th, which is St. Patrick's Day. But more importantly, we are here to tell you about a great show that we have coming up live from the pavilion at Renninger's Farmers Market. It's a mega May 1st craft show. And like I said, May 1st. And we have right there is Steve Hunter, and he is our program chairperson tonight, and we're going to talk to him. But I'm going to go ahead and introduce all our guests who'll be with us, and then we're going to talk to Steve and Barry about how this show all came about. Okay, so please welcome our first guest, who will be talking a little later, is Martha Ressler. And Martha is an internationally known fiber artist. She does amazing art quilts, and she was my guest in November. So if you totally miss that show, you'll be sorry, and you can catch it on, go to rbcrafts.org, and you can catch it on there and or on YouTube. Okay, secondly, we will be talking to Lisa Teller Short, and Lisa is a self-taught folk artist, and she does fractur and folk art. She's been featured many, many times in Early Americans Life Annual Directory of Best Traditional Artists in America. Then thirdly, we will be going to John Fugelso. John is a craftsman, a historian, a problem solver, an educator, and he does spoon making, and he will be with us a little later on too. We will then go on to Jay Ressler, who is an award-winning Pennsylvania fine art photographer. He is also president of the Berks Art Alliance. So we're going to be happy to talk with Jay in just a little bit. And then right here is Barry Bennecoff. He is the maker of country and primitive furniture. He's also been chosen for Early Americans Life Annual Directory of Best Traditional Artisans in America. And he's president of the Renninger Berks Guild. And then last but not least, like I said, Steve Hunter, who is Master Potter, and he is our show chairperson who does all of our, produces all of our shows for the Renninger Berks Guild of Craftsmen. And if that's not enough, he's also a maker of some beautiful, beautiful stoneware. So, hey, Steve, tell us how this show started, or how we got to this point.
Well, I guess it's sort of like we said, where can we sell stuff? And we were looking for an outdoor venue that was kind of COVID friendly, and we didn't want to do like an outdoor show. A lot of our members don't like things getting wet or blown away. And I was talking to Barry, and then I remembered, or he remembered, that the Renningers has a huge, several huge pavilions out in the, at their market that they use for the extravaganza and other things. And let's go see that. And Renningers was very happy to work with us. So went and looked at the space, which is going to be great. And we're going to book our show on May 1st, and it's a jewelry craft show. We have a lot of our members here are going to do it. We have a few other people from other guilds and areas that have also entered. So very excited about it. We haven't done an outdoor show as a guild for quite a while, and we'll see how it goes. But we're expecting great things.
Yeah, and it's very nice for our craftsmen to pull up there. It's easy for them to park right at their space and everything. We're going to be socially distanced, right? Masks.
Right, and it will be set up with space between the booths so that we're not going to be crowded in. The booths are spacious. The walkways are spacious. The parking is ample. There's no fee. So it should make it easier. It runs from 9 o'clock in the morning till 3 in the afternoon. So should be convenient for a lot of people. And we know there's some pent up excitement to get out there and do something different and hopefully acquire some new crafts. A lot of our craftsmen have been working very hard over the winter and over the last year. And they want to show their stuff and sell their stuff too. So I'm just really looking forward to it.
Yeah, and I think that all of our past patrons, you know, of our shows are anxious to see us as well. I know that Barry and you have worked hard, you know, and our whole board, you know, and trying to come up with, you know, a good idea, you know, and to help our craftsmen and everything. And
yeah. It's been a tough year for craftsmen. I mean, a lot of us have sold almost nothing. And have plenty of time to make things, but it's trying because you're stuck in the process and you can you're piling stuff up or you don't know what to do with it. And now we have a goal. We can see we have some opportunities from this show and others. We have of course our fall show in November.
Yes, we're so excited about that.
We'll tell you more about that later on. And there are other guilds have shows coming up also. So, but we're the first and we think we'll be the best. So excited about that.
Oh, absolutely. Barry, do you want to say anything right here?
Steve pretty well covered it. I mean, this is going to be a great event. I don't think the Renninger Berks Guild has done an outdoor event since Owl's Field used to be their spring show, which was an open space.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I hope hope everyone's happy. So I'm sure they will be.
And we're just going to remind everyone that it's the week before Mother's Day, so it should be a good shopping day, right?
You know, May 1st.
All mothers deserve beautiful gifts for Mother's Day.
We have a lot. We are the largest guild, and I believe we're the second oldest guild in Pennsylvania, and we have a great history of quality crafts and wonderful members who will love to tell you about their crafts and spend some time with you. It's just not pick something out and get out of my booth. We really care, and we want you to come back again and again to our shows and bring friends and just have a great time. There's also going to be food available, and of course the Renninger's market is open, which is antiques and a traditional country market with stall type things for butchers and vegetables and bakery items and great steak sandwiches and things like that. So I would expect that anybody who comes would walk through the market also. So
sure. And there's one more thing that day also I learned from Jim Renninger. His daughter-in-law is going to be they have another pavilion out there too. And so they're going to be having a kids thing there. And so they have some kids' clothes and toys and stuff. So that's going to be in another pavilion over there also that day. So it should be quite exciting, you know, and an eventful day.
I think it's going to be great. I'm very excited about this. And, the show that we worked on so hard last fall was canceled. And some of our other shows in the Kutztown area are canceled or the format's changed. Right. So we're excited. I'm excited as a craftsman to get out and show things and show new products and get back doing what I like to do best, which is selling and just displaying my craft.
Yeah. Okay.
Their last big event they held there had 33,000 people come through the event. So let's hope we get a big turnout.
That would be great.
Yeah, we know what that was. You know, I plan on going to the train show they're having at the end of the month and check out
for
spacing and things like that. So, and Barry will join me and other people too. So,
yeah, and we thank you for doing that. Okay, you know, okay. So, well, hey, you know what? Without further ado, we're just going to get started and meet these artists and craftspersons and makers, okay? So if you're ready, Miss Martha, I'm going to start with you. And I just want to reiterate, if you missed my November show with Martha, you really missed something. So you have to go back into the archives and watch that show. Okay, Martha, take it away.
Okay. Hi, everybody. Welcome to my studio in Tilden Township near Hamburg, Pennsylvania. I make art quilts. I use my sewing machine. I use my ironing table, my design wall. This is our big work table that Jay and I built a number of years ago. It's an 8x8 foot table. Wow. All of my fabrics are organized by color. I'm pulling out the reds. I'm not the most organized in the world, but I need to see each fabric, each piece, at least a little bit of it, so I can pick out what I want for a particular job I'm doing. Every quilt starts with either plain unbleached cotton muslin like this. This is what it looks like to start with. Or a wool felt. I use this for some smaller ones that are hand stitched. And that's all I get to start with. I don't use any kits. Everything is original. These are some small ones that are waiting to be framed that I've just finished. This is a small landscape called Sun Between the Two Trees, I think, something like that. This is one that I did a series of the Reading Pagoda, starting with vintage postcards that I bought at an antique store. And collaged, and you know, you can see some of the hand embroidery there and different fabrics that I thought would go well with it. This is another one from that series, one of the Reading Pagoda postcards and a vintage sort of romantic Victorian looking thing of a woman by a pond. These are some that I will have at the show that are already framed, and Jay, my husband, makes my frames out of hardwood ash, which we harvest from our property. Unfortunately, the ash trees have all been killed by emerald ash borer, but we save the wood and make frames out of them. This one is called Reading Pagoda and 53 Chevy.
That'll be close to a lot of people's hearts.
Another Reading Pagoda with a wooden nickel. Again, you know, hand stitched, framed. Another one from that series, I think I imaginatively called that the Pagoda and a Bird. Let's see. Yeah, Pagoda and Birdie. So there's those. I will have a number that are left from a series I did called Berks in Stitches, where I followed along with the Reading Eagle in their series on villages and townships in Berks County. Went to each place. Sometimes I used vintage papers or items that I bought in an antique store. This one is Penn Township, very big farming community. I went out there and saw these farmer had these wooden cutout cows in his lawn with Santa hats. I thought that was
that's very cute.
Tilden Township, where I live, another very agricultural and rural area. Richmond Township, where Crystal Cave is, another vintage postcard of Crystal Cave. So I'll have a number of these available. I'll show you a few of my little bit larger landscape quilts. This is one of a rural scene, actually here in Tilden Township also. It's called Winter Farm in the Valley.
Awesome.
This is more of a summer piece from Ocracoke, North Carolina, where we like to vacation. A lot of hand stitching on this one. And sometimes I use actual objects, in this case, these shells. This is another landscape quilt I used false color. It's a realistic, more or less abstracted, realistic landscape, but I chose this complementary color scheme for that.
Very nice.
And this is one of the Schuylkill River here in Hamburg.
Oh.
Did this actually plein air outside. I took everything with me outside and did it right then and there outside.
Oh yeah, that was done. Yeah, you did that down in West Reading, right, Martha? That was down in West Reading. You did that down in West Reading?
No, that's in Hamburg, the Hamburg Park at Schuylkill River. These are some other things I'll be having. These are sort of popular. I call them friendship wine totes. People give me their old blue jeans and I make heaps of them.
Very nice.
You can gift wine bottle with these and invite their friend to pass them along, therefore friendship wine tote. And also my hand-stitched cards I will have. Birthdays, Mother's Day, and so forth. Each one is unique.
Absolutely. How special. And I know I brag about you all the time and you get embarrassed, but you are so talented.
Thank you, Kay.
You're welcome. And thank you for sharing that. And again, you will see Martha at the pop-up show on May 1st. Thank you. Okay, let's go on to Lisa.
Okay. Hi, Barry. Like the shirt, Barry.
Thank you.
Boy, that just for you, Lisa.
Thank you. So I do, as Kay had introduced me earlier, I do mostly Fraktur. I also do Pennsylvania German style decorative painting on like small pieces of furniture, some cupboards, and sometimes I use some found objects as well. So I started doing Fraktur over 20 years ago. I don't know the exact date, but I've always been interested in the craft of the Pennsylvania German and all the decoration and the history of it all. And I had also always grown up around antiques. And I know when I was a teenager, my parents took me to an antique show. And that is where they had an exhibit of Pennsylvania German Fraktur. And I just kind of, that was it for me. I was hooked. Between that and blanket chests, I just, it's just been my passion. And, you know, I at the antique show, I was interested in purchasing a Fraktur, and I didn't realize that, you know, it was something I couldn't afford on a teenager's salary. So like many other things artists do, we just kind of create our own. So that's really when I started, you know, making my own Pennsylvania German style Fraktur pieces. Mm-hmm. I would like to do a screen share, and I'll just show you some of my my items that'll be for sale, and I'll share my technique. And let me just get this going here.
Okay.
So can you see my screen?
I can. Very
okay.
Nice.
Okay. So. So my references really come from all over. I'm a little bit of a book junkie. I can't have enough books, especially if it pertains to anything Pennsylvania German. When I first started, it was kind of hard to find information on Fraktur other than books or say auction catalogs. But today with all the online resources, one of the biggest is the Free Library in Pennsylvania, in Philadelphia. And they even have all of their Fraktur now. You're able to view it digitally. So nice. It's really great that there's a lot more access, and just web searches, I find images there. What I do pretty much is I feel like I can't improve on the original designs, although I've always sort of been striving to find my own style, my own hand at it. Mm-hmm. And I think that happens just naturally, but I really try to emulate the originals as much as possible, going back to that first love when I first saw those originals at that antique show, and just, you know, having the passion to. So I do make mine sort of look antique, And a lot of my collectors are people that have, you know, antique furniture or antique homes. And but really, I feel like my art can go anywhere. So these are the tools I use. I use on the right side of the screen are just the original old nib pens. These are metal tip pens that usually have a split in them to get sort of thick and thin lines when you put pressure on the point. And they have to be dipped into the India ink. So I don't use like a ink pen of any kind. I just use this old style. Originally they used the goose quill to do the fractures. And I have experimented with that a little bit. I need to do a little more research on that because there's a special way to split the quill to get it to work well. And then after I do my pen and ink drawing, I use watercolors to put the color into my paintings. So I usually also use laid paper because laid paper, as opposed to watercolor paper, was the original paper that was around in the 18th century when they were first, you know, creating these documents for documenting like births or marriages and such.
May I ask a question, Lisa?
Sure, absolutely.
When you said laid paper, what is the spelling of that?
L-A-I-D. It's just okay. The finish of the paper. The first papers that were created in Ephrata and Germantown, Pennsylvania, had a finish on them in the process of making the paper that created a sort of aligned texture on the paper. And that's called a laid finish. Oh. There's also like a wove finish too that looks more like a woven fabric. Oh. Okay, but the earliest papers were the laid papers, and that's what I try to use. And you can actually see that texture. Mm-hmm. If you look closely at my fractures, you'll see that texture in the paintings.
Okay, and one more question.
Sure, go ahead.
And are the pens you use, are those old or are they?
No, they're not. I'm always on the lookout for, you know, old pens, but the nibs don't really hold up and they kind of wear down. And if they get gunked up, they get rusty and nasty. So, you might find a holder, but you're not going to probably find an antique nib, the metal part that goes in the holder.
That's what I was thinking, but I thought, oh, they looked pretty old. So I thought I'd ask that question.
I'll try to play this video. This is just showing the nib pen. And the reason I really like using the nib pen is you'll see when I apply pressure, I get a thick and thin line. Mm-hmm. And you can't get that with like a rapidograph pen or a fine point marker or anything. It does take a while to get used to it because, you know, this is wet until it dries and I've already smeared them and spilled my ink on my artwork. But I love the feel I get to feel the paper and to get that pressure of getting that fine detail in a thin line. I just love the feel. You can hear it scratching the paper.
Yeah.
Yeah, Kate, so, you're scratching a chalkboard.
Sorry about that.
No, that's okay. I think you've taken some of the fear out of me trying that, because it looks very much, you know, very fun.
It is fun. I'm always smiling when I'm drawing because it's kind of a good therapy for me. This is just a little bit about the history of Fractur. Really is about the text part. I don't use a lot of text in my fractures, just because I struggle with with the writing. But the word fractur actually comes from the Latin of broken type. If you look at the first letter in this example, it's not connected and it sort of has a fractured look. And a lot of the old fractures, if you look at them, you'll see, you know, the break between parts of the letters, and that's where they get the word fractur from. Today, they sort of group it all together with the pictorial parts of original fractures, and they just call it all fractur. But really, if you just have a pictorial part, like as an example here, there's a little bit of both. it's still considered Fraughter because it comes from that reference. Mm-hmm. This is an example there on the left is my reference of Andreas Kolb piece. And on the right is my interpretation of that. It's pretty close to the original, only the original was much smaller than my version. I do try to use the German script as long as I know what the translation is. So this one, I just translated it because the script was a little hard to figure out all the lettering. So I just sort of did it in that textural style. Nice. And I mostly use frames that I grain paint myself, but I sometimes find antique frames and I'll use them. And I always like to use antique glass. I just think it just gives it a little bit. If you look at it on an angle, you'll see the waves in the glass. And
yeah.
I just think that sort of helps to give it the antique look that I love so much.
Absolutely. Lisa, thank you. Oh, okay. Go ahead. One more.
Oh, okay. Am I out of time?
Well, you know, we're going to come back if we have time. I just want to make sure okay. I get all these talented people in here.
All right. Let me just show a couple of my...
No, they're lovely.
My painted cupboards. So these are the cupboards I paint. They're made by a local cabinet maker. My father used to make them, and since he passed, I've had to have them made by a local person. And they're all grain painted and painted in the style of the Pennsylvania Germans also.
Oh, those are
hardware beautiful. Comes from a local blacksmith as well. And these are a couple pieces I did that were custom. So that's it for me.
I'll stop sharing now. That was a good review, you know, for everyone to see what they will find on May 1st at our Mega Spring Craft Show.
Looking forward to it. Thank you, Kay.
Yeah. Lisa, do I have to call you to get you to apply to our spring show?
No, you don't. The check is in the mail.
Okay. Thank you.
That's a little private joke there between Barry and Lisa. He's always calling her, reminding her.
Sorry about that.
But I think she just likes that, right, Lisa?
I do. Makes me feel special.
You are. You all are.
Okay. As are you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much. Okay, so now we're going to move over and we're going to talk to John. John, where are you there, buddy? John Figelso, okay.
I'm here in my shop, which is in my basement. I've been doing various kinds of woodworking all my life, about as long as I could pick up a knife. I always say it always started in Boy Scouts. They give you a knife and a hatchet and turn you loose on a tree. What can I say? But I have been, like many others, locked away in my basement making things. And one thing I really like about spoon making, particular spoons and bowls, working with wood, it's a very grounding sort of a craft. The tree comes from the earth, you know, you make something out of it, you root yourself back to the earth in it, and they're all very useful objects. Some of my inspirations come from collecting things when I travel. Now, I don't know how you can see this on the screen, because I only see a little me, I don't see a big...
Okay, I think we're pretty good, just hold it up there.
This is a spoon I collected in Morocco.
Okay.
Made out of lemon wood. They're ubiquitous. They're all over the place. On that same trip, we were in Greece and we were at the National Museum. And I saw this same shape in a case in the museum labeled Some Pharaoh's Tomb 3000 BC. 3,000 BC. This shape is thousands of years old. And that's the thing about spoons. The shape is, it's organic. It just, you know, you can make it a little bit different, but it's got a handle, it's got a bowl, and these shapes and these forms repeat over time. They're timeless. The space and time mean nothing to these wooden shapes. Other things that I've been doing recently that you'll see at the show, I have a new rooster spoon. It's made out of basswood. And these, I'm sort of starting a series of spoons. I'm calling sort of my cartoon spoons. They're supposed to say goose. Not really be goose, but say goose.
say goose.
Now, I showed this to some of my wood carving friends, and one of the wise comments I got in the very beginning is, oh, that looks like a wood duck. There's a duck that says mallard. These are fun. I'm kind of inspired by, let's say, Looney Tunes.
Uh-huh.
Foghorn Leghorn.
You got it. King of the Barnyard. There's his crown.
There you go.
Crown designed to say King of the Barnyard.
John, this is a question. So you started this during the COVID, right?
I've been making, this came out during COVID, but I've been making roosters for years. They've just evolved in shape.
Okay.
Some of the things that I've done in COVID have been a new series of strainers.
Okay.
This is made out of maple. And I was working on some maple. This is a Asian stir fry spatula. But you can see that there were a lot of wormholes.
Mm-hmm.
So I filled it with 5-minute epoxy and glitter. I think it came out. You see bull turners doing that when they have holes.
Mm-hmm.
They filled it with turquoise. I priced turquoise. I thought that was ridiculous. But I've had to pay for the turquoise. Maybe don't want to buy the spoon. Like Rosado spoons.
Mm-hmm.
Special, different, sort of unique wooden spoons. This is also called the diet spoon.
That's good.
Salad servers. Sycamore.
Yeah, those are nice.
Tulip design. Sort of looks like a tulip.
Yeah, it does.
This is a tulip salad server. I like to have some kind of organic. This is growing out of the ground. It's very, mm-hmm. very grounded. Of course, spatulas.
Mm-hmm.
Different sizes and shapes.
And we all use them.
The last bit of my sycamore, I had a whole bunch of sycamore that was pretty dried out. So that was the last of it. And then serving spoons.
Mm-hmm.
A nice medium-sized serving spoon.
Mm-hmm.
And sort of combination serving and mixing with a little finial twist on the end of it. Defined bowl. This is a birch, very traditional. This one's actually American chestnut. It came from a fence rail I salvaged out of a historic building I worked on.
Mm-hmm.
Floor joist. It was an old fence rail used for a floor joist. It happened to be American chestnut.
I appreciate all the artists who use salvaged parts, and I give them another life. I enjoy that.
There's another bird spoon.
Yeah.
This one, a very, very simple finial that says I'm a bird and I'm flying along. and other useful household objects.
Oh, yeah.
The tong.
Mm-hmm.
With tulip, poplar, cherry, and inlet walnut, which is mostly decoration. It's not very structural.
Yeah, really woods. Yeah, definitely.
Oh, this is my modern take on
the salad.
The salad server. These are white cedar. So as you can see, I use a lot of different woods.
Just a wonderful array. And which mother wouldn't want one of these, for Mother's Day, right? So.
Good serving spoon or discipline.
Gotcha. Okay. John, thank you so much for sharing all of that. We did really do appreciate all the different styles that you have there, plus all the woods are great.
And this is sycamore.
Mm-hmm.
It just started today.
Oh, okay.
Doing hand work.
Okay.
A lot of my work is done hand.
Right. And you'll be demonstrating a little bit at the show, right?
A little bit. You'll see me doing things like this.
Yes. Perfect. Okay. Well, we look forward to seeing you on May 1st. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, John. Thanks for sharing with us tonight. Okay. We're going to move on to our next person. We're going to call out for Jay. Where's Jay? Hey, Jay.
Thanks, how are you? Thanks for hosting this. Oh, I'm going to immediately go to screen share because my art is, whoops, I just did something I didn't want to do. There we go.
Okay.
What I'm known for is my composite photos. This is one where I combined an original photo of the old Drabblebush Bridge with some textures to create a kind of interesting take on the bridge.
That was beautiful.
This is another one of my composites. This is one that was in the Art of the State in Harrisburg a couple of years ago. And this is a recent one called Getting to the Roots, kind of a colorful take on agriculture. Mm-hmm. This is a fun piece that I call Halloween is So Confusing for Some Creatures. So these photo prints, which are all digital creations layered with several layers, I'll have prints of those available on May 1st. But I want to talk about some of the things I've been doing lately, which is involving some ancient techniques with some more modern techniques.
Oh, good.
This photo is a glitched photo created using some gaming software on a mobile device called BlueStacks with an add-on called Glitch Labs that allows you to corrupt photos in all kinds of interesting ways. Mm. And of course, I framed it in one of my stained ash frames. Now, the thing about this is it's a wax infused photo. I use encaustic medium, which is one of the oldest forms of painting. They're encaustic paintings that have been found in tombs in Egypt going back 5,000 years.
Oh, wow.
So I use a clear medium in these photos to bind the photo to a board, which is treated with a special kind of gesso that is different from what acrylic and oil painters use. It's got more texture.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't work very well with oils or acrylics, but works really great with wax because the wax medium binds to it. This is a piece called Octopus in a Cornfield. This is based on a photo I shot in Antigua of purses and plants on display at a roadside market. 100 degrees in the shade. Still harbor.
Like that.
Safe harbor. This is a little bit smaller piece. It's a 5x7 in a frame, which is it's not one of my ash frames. This is cedar that I've stained and cut and designed a little bit differently. This is a really small piece, 3.5x5.5. I think all the ones you're going to see in the next little series are pretty small, either 4x6 or 3.5x5.5. Many are framed. You'll see a lot of the imperfections because they're blown up so much. Some of these are in these distressed kind of vintage frames. Again, 3.5x5.5.
Yeah, they're beautiful though.
This is one based on a pagoda I saw in China. A little bit different style. This is a little bit bigger than the 3.5, 5.5. This is a hardwood frame. This is our pagoda. This is my workstation.
Okay.
It's actually, in many ways, a hand-built computer. I ordered this computer from Tiger Direct, but it didn't have many of the features I wanted, so I added a hard drive, a bunch of memory, and this and that to it. Got a gaming keyboard and a second monitor so that I'm able to do what I want. Now, I mentioned that I use a gaming program. Actually, the gaming program I use is designed for mobile devices, but I got a version that is an emulation that I use on my PC. So I have a lot more control over it. This is my professional grade printer. Now, Martha uses this too to print on fabric. It's a very versatile printer, prints up to 17 inches wide, 9 color colors of ink. This is a my matting and framing table. I took a rather inexpensive matting guide and incorporated into a bigger table with a big angle guide, and use it for both matting and framing and finishing the framing. These are all waiting to be wired and backed.
Wow.
This is, now I want to talk about a little bit about encaustics. This is my encaustic studio. It's in a separate room from our regular studio, so I can have an exhaust fan and turn off the fire alarm in that room. I often, when I start this griddle up, I have to have a fan behind, both an exhaust fan and a fan behind me, because it gets kind of smoky for a few minutes.
Wow.
I do all my work on a layer of craft paper because I spill wax all over the place. I make this encaustic medium. I pour it into a cupcake tin to get these little cupcakes of medium. The medium starts with Damar resin, which is a natural hardener that comes from sap of a tree in the Middle East, grinded up in a mortar and pestle, and incorporated one part of that to 8 parts of beeswax. Cook it for a few hours in a slow cooker. And then what I'm doing here with these photos that I print regular, just regular old paper, is I put a couple layers of wax on a board, usually birch ply, 1/4-inch birch ply, and put a couple layers of wax on, then use these fusing irons to draw the wax through it. This is so wax medium on the griddle in liquid form that I paint on. Now the boards have to be heated with a heat gun before I can lay it down. Otherwise it bubbles up and hardens too quickly. So the board has to be fairly warm to apply the wax. These are encaustic pigments that I can use to paint. If you remember the griddle, I had a little cat food can with a little bit of black in it that I used to paint the edges of the boards. This is what I use to clean the wax brushes, soy waxes. Dip them in a hot soy wax, and it'll help clean the wax medium out of the brushes. Now I want to talk a little bit about my frame making shop. This is where I stain and assemble my frames. It's my staining bench and assembly bench. Down in the bottom, you'll see the blue tray with the ratchet straps. I modify the ratchet straps so they're a big loop and I can pull the frames together and square. These are some that have had the rough sanding done on my sanding bench. Again, I have an exhaust fan there to draw out the dust while I'm sanding, as well as a whole dust collection system.
Yeah.
I get very tight corners because of the way I do it. You have an 80 tooth saw that gets very fine cuts for the joints. And to cut the molding strips, I use this ripping radial arm saw. And there's my dust collection system, my 6 gallon air compressor, the two heads, shop vac. It's very dusty with all the sanding I do. So I need that dust collection.
Yeah.
And this is a tabletop planer that I use to plane the boards from the ash trees that we cut down and had a neighbor make boards out of. A neighbor has got a sawmill.
Okay.
So that's it.
Yeah, Jay, this is fantastic. I'm impressed by the whole technique of what you go through and what goes into these beautiful, beautiful pictures that you do. Thank you so much for sharing. Jay will be at our Mega Craft Show on May 1st, and we're so happy to have you join us that day again.
All right, thanks very much, Kay.
Thank you, Jay. Okay, how about Stephen Barry, right? Okay, who's going to go next?
I'll take a few minutes and go through a couple pieces.
Okay, Barry's just going to show you a few pieces of furniture that we will have.
Move that.
Okay, I'm going to over there. Okay.
One of our newer pieces that we've been working on, cupboard above, drawers, and a new desk. Desk has a lift top, also has a large roomy drawer. We've got grommets in through and through for laptop, whatever you want to put on here, or charge your phone, whatever it could be. Very nice piece. The cupboard has plate grooves in, whatever you want to put in there, but books would fit in very nicely above your desk also.
Mm-hmm.
And then let's go to the pantry. Pantry's been a pretty new item, been very popular. Adjustable shelves in it for anything you want to put into it. Cane goods or spices on the doors. Very nice setup. Doesn't take up a whole lot of room. Started out actually with an idea for a linen press, and it moved on. At one point it became an armoire, and now it's a pantry.
So we've done it in different versions.
Done lots of different versions of this piece. So
this is our
very nice. All of our hardware is made by one of the guild blacksmiths, Dave Fisher. Kay does most of the finishing on all the furniture. I do the staining, but she does all the painting and finishing.
Okay. I'm quality control. Okay, Steve, why don't you, is that it, Barry?
Yeah.
Okay, Steve, how about you?
Okay, I'm going to grab the screen here, and I have a presentation. So I kind of walk you through the process that I do. As being a potter, I sometimes make my own clay. I always make my own glazes. I've made my own kilns.
Did you say you make your own clay?
I mix my own clay, yes.
Oh, mix it. Okay, very good.
So hang on here.
Okay.
Are you seeing this or not?
Now we're seeing you.
What am I doing? Why am I seeing you?
Share.
How about this?
There we go.
Okay. I have two little video clips here. I'll start those.
Okay. I'm going to make a tumbler.
I'll just give you a quick clip here, and then I'll move to the next one here.
Okay.
But I make using bunches of things.
I'm using a Randall Potter's wheel with a motor and about a pound and a half of clay. It looks like the camera's falling over. Accidents happen gallery all the time. So I got that centered. It's a little stiffer than I usually like to throw. Do about 2.5 or 3.5 holes on this. I usually do with a half on the bottom because it's a little thicker. Gotta get the rough shape in here. This is the rib I'm using. I don't know if I'm using it like they wanted me to use it, but the angle's pretty close to a glass, so finishing the very top.
He makes it look so easy, like he's done this before.
There it is.
The first 10,000 are hard, but then it gets easier.
I was going to say, the noise I'm hearing, that's the wheel, not your joints, right?
That's the motor that Barry gave me.
Oh, okay.
You gave that motor back.
You might get it. So let me go. I'm going to clip this one short. So I'm going to walk you through the couple steps here. And there's only two clips here.
Okay.
This is a plate that I'm going to trim here.
I thought you'd like to see a side view of the trimming. So I just cut a little bit of the edge off here. And put my marks here for how wide I need to go. And then I'm going to trim it down to there.
The most important part.
Mm-hmm. No, signing it, yes. Everyone signs their piece. They need to do
that. I didn't show that in the other video. You just take the little foot out here and just slide it back. And now, looks like a plate. It's going to dry. Yeah. It's going to shrink. We're going to glaze it. It's going to be pretty.
All right, let's take a look at those steps. So these are just some big water jugs I made, and they're drying. You can see the top of them, they're drier than the bottom. And mm-hmm. There's a hole for a valve at the bottom, or a spigot. And the Maxwell coffee can gives you a scale of this. So all the pieces are added between now and when it was a little bit wetter. Mm-hmm. This is how I make an object. This is going to be a butter keeper. So these are closed forms. Just thrown them. Then I turned them on their side and added handles, two handles. It's still a closed form. And then I've, now you see I've cut a lid off of it. You can see the line. And these are drier, so they're not nearly as gray. Mm-hmm. And then here's one that's glazed. So that'll hold a stick of butter.
Nice.
Very nice.
Yeah. So the stuff gets dried. This stuff has been fired once. It's fired twice. And this is just like a, it's porous like a flower pot. So this is on the rack ready to get glazed. There's a couple on the bottom that are glazed. Here they are glazed, but not cooked. So this is the inside of my larger kiln, which is fired with propane. And they're stacked up. And I'll close the door here. And there's some fire. And then 3 days later, you can get this out of it. So this is the stuff in the kiln still. Took a picture. This is mostly brown, but I do other colors, as you'll see. This is a dinner set I made for somebody.
Oh, very nice. Perfect.
This is a bunch of brown stuff. Sort of brown things. But it's mostly functional cookware. It's all oven proof and dishwasher safe. This is a casserole in the center and some serving pieces. These are vases. They're a neutral. And they're waterproof, of course, for flowers. You can put them in. These are, I collaborated with artist Lisa Short, who is, you just saw her work. So mm-hmm. I convinced her to draw in some of my pots and sold several of these at the Guild store in Lancaster. So we've been happy with that. So
very nice.
Yes.
Okay. Well, you know, I am so happy that we got all of these fine artists and makers and craftsmen here tonight, okay, because we are so excited about our show. Did you want to say something here, Steve, because we're
I know we're going to be out of time here, so
we're going to be out of time soon, so if we can bring us all back.
I'm trying to stop sharing us here.
No, that's okay. I'm going to keep talking, okay, because our show is May 1st. The Mega Spring Craft Show out at Renninger's Farmers Market. And just so we know, the address is 740 Noble Street in Kutztown, and the zip code is 19530. We also have been doing little pop-ups, you know, in February, March, and April. So there's a little room at Renninger's called the White Room, and we will be there one more time before the Mega pop-up, and we'll be there on April 3rd, the day before Easter, and we'll be in the White Room, and there's six artists from the Renninger Berks Guild of Craftsmen who will be there. It'll be Barry Bennecoff, Carol Hiley, Amy Langman, a nature photographer, John Fugelso is going to join us, the spoon maker,
Patricia, Alan Whiteman.
Patricia Halsey, a fine jewelry, and Alan Whiteman from
the Stoneware Potter.
He's a stoneware potter as well. So they'll be there on the day before Easter. And as we said, Steve, we'll be back in the big pavilion May 1st.
All right. You can hardly wait. Thank you, Kay.
Okay. No, thank you, everyone. And we'll be back next month. Okay. And we're going to have some more artists and craftsmen and makers who will be at the May 1st show, too. So we're going to be doing this all over with several more artists.
This show is so anticipated that we had to do two TV shows.
Two TV shows, right. Okay. Okay. Again, thank you to everyone. And we'll see you next time on Your Berks Craftsmen.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank
you.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. Your Berks Craftsmen on BCTV is supported by the Kutztown Folk Festival and by the Renninger Berks Guild of Craftsmen.